Part 5, The New Age and the Left-Hand Path. The cults we've considered so far have been exotic offshoots of major religions, mostly Christian, but one bastard Muslim and one Buddhist. The would-be true believer looking for a better-than-average spiritual home, however, does not necessarily express his dissatisfaction with the conformist centre by pushing to an extreme position on its edges. He may move into direct opposition, inventing an entirely new religion of his own, or declaring his worship for society's official enemy, if it has one. So our fin de siècle and fin d'époque period has witnessed an upsurge in young, rebellious people wearing swastikas. Sexually normal people have paraded in clothes which suggest sadomasochistic fetishism. And there has been much organised anti-Christianity. Not the reasoned objection to any belief in the supernatural put about by the humanist and rationalist societies, but rampant irrationalism by self-defined groups of witches or Satanists, or proponents of brand new belief systems. Witchcraft and Satanism offer the thrill of a guilty secret. Practicing pagans, as witches who don't worship the devil often like to call themselves, don't do any harm. But some of their neighbours might be shocked if they knew exactly what they get up to. So there's the added pleasure of being a little bit naughty, the added tension of not wanting to be caught at it, lending excitement. Despite lurid suggestions in the tabloid press, your friendly neighbourhood witch coven has yet to be found guilty of any kind of murder or child abuse. They prance about naked or sky-clad in their sitting rooms, or out in the fields and woods. They dance around stone circles and megaliths on Midsummer's Day and Halloween, if any happen to be available, leaving their clothes behind them. They chant nature-worshipping rituals that may or may not be accompanied by a little ritual copulation. Sexual acts as religious rituals have a very ancient and respectable history, despite the hostility with which Judaism, Christianity, and Islam view them. Suburban witches nearly always claim that they are adherents of the old pre-Christian religion of Europe and worshipping a feminine principle of the earth and possibly a masculine horned god. They insist that there is a scholarly basis for this belief, which they often call Wicca. And they are wrong. In 1931, an anthropologist called Margaret Murray studied the testimony given at the innumerable witch trials in Europe and America between the 14th and 18th centuries. She was struck by the extraordinary similarity of the witches' confessions and concluded they must be based on some genuine experience. She postulated that this was a nature cult which had flourished all over the Celtic Empire until Rome and Christianity conquered the Celts and drove their religion underground. Other pieces of folk life were dragged in as supposed survivals of the ancient cult, the long tradition of green men or woodwoses, the wild men of the woods, for example, the horned figure of Herne the Wild Hunter of Windsor Forest, or the horn-bearing dancers of Abbots Bromley. Since Celtic civilization was illiterate, and the only written records of its religious practices are brief propagandist attacks in Roman writings, Margaret Murray could say pretty much what she chose about what the old religion must have been. She propounded an academic theory, and was distressed that her fellow anthropologists unanimously dismissed it. They pointed out that it had long been known that most witches' confessions were extracted by torture, and almost all took the forms their accusers expected to hear. The sources of official superstitious belief in witchcraft were well known. They could be traced to medieval documents and books, and largely represented the nasty imaginings of some medieval clerics. Modern parallels with Africa, where some tribes believed in witches, and some people confessed to witch doctors that they'd been flying at night or cursing their neighbours' cattle, showed that malleable souls are easily persuaded to believe they have done impossible things, if the whole of society avers they must have. Margaret Murray's refusal to amend her theory in the light of these objections earned her a reputation as a crank, and until the 1960s, just about the only person who agreed with her in taking witches' confessions seriously was the dubious priest Father Montague Summers. he lurked around Oxford in biretta and cassock, and published vastly learned books, amassing mountainous quantities of witch confessions. Summers believed they were all true. He believed thousands of people were and are in league with the devil. He believed it was the most monstrous crime conceivable, and he wanted the death sentence for witches returned to the statute book. It served this unpleasant scholar right that a lot of people privately thought he was a black magician himself, and probably either unfrocked or ordained by some dubious schismatic bishop not recognised by any proper church. The founder father of Wicca, Gerald Gardner, called himself the King of the Witches, and made great play with the herbal medical skills of old wise women. Alternative natural medicine enthusiasts, faith healers, and would-be witches all rejoice in the accidental discovery of penicillin from a mould. This, they suggest, hopefully shows that ancient wise women and witches knew from trial and error that their nasty poultices of spiders' webs and sheep's blood really were curative. Gardner and his imitators quite obviously used ritual as magic, seeking tangible benefits from their chants and spells. Poor old Christians were sneered at for allegedly believing that the power of prayer might help them win the pools, even though the more serious of them insisted that the practice of the presence of God was the real point, and they were quite sure prayer wouldn't work at all if uttered with evil or selfish intent. But Gardner and his imitators unabashedly invited initiates to join in a spot of nude dancing or a little formal love-making in a setting of candles and daggers and goblets, with the hope of getting very rich as a bonus. Some of them sold love filters or lucky charms. And they were all suspiciously careful to insist that though there was black magic and occult techniques could be used for revenge on enemies, they themselves would never, never, never do such things. Interested parties were always advised to steer well clear of black magicians, wicked witches, and Satanists. Forms of supposed black magic certainly thrive underground in parts of the Western world where large parts of the population are of African origin. Black slaves were forbidden by their Christian masters to practice their traditional religions, and so some secret ritual practices were handed down, often with the expectation that they would bring luck. Obeah, throughout the West Indies, tends to involve doing nasty things to chickens or frogs, and expecting that this will bring down bad luck on an enemy or cause a lawsuit or tax demand to be dropped. Bush baths, administered by village wise women with mixed herbs, are often believed to bring success in exams or elections. I myself once drove a friend, at her request, to a remote house in Barbados, where she hoped that a wise man, using formulae drawn from the rituals of the quasi-Masonic Mechanics Society, would lift the curse she believed an enemy had put on her. The notorious witch trials at Salem, Massachusetts, in the 17th century, resulted from some children playing at Obeah's spells under the instruction of the slave woman Tituba. Pocomania in Jamaica, and similar cults in other islands, tend to involve the pretty revolting sacrifice of goats, coupled with heavy imbibing of moonshine rum. Haitian voodoo, on the other hand, retains deep elements of an African possession religion. Worshippers dance themselves into a trance, and then start acting wildly in imitation of the saints or tribal gods they believe have come to possess them. All these things may be unearthed in various debased forms in the poorer quarters of some southern American cities. Like the children of Salem, some unsophisticated white people may also hope that some sort of good luck may come to them if they can trace practitioners of these African black arts. Gerald Gardner's white Wicca certainly had some familiarity with black magic too, and Gardner drew some of his rituals from its main modern Western source. Black magic, or the left-hand path, is very influential in cults that kill. Its present role in England and America owes a lot to one half-charlatan and another downright charlatan who flourished at the end of the 19th and beginning of the 20th centuries. Helena Petrovna Blavatsky was the half-charlatan. In 1856, when she was 25 years old, this pop-eyed Russian travelled in the Himalayas and was one of the few Europeans to enter Tibet. She was fascinated by the religious culture she found there, and her real importance is that she was one of the first Europeans to grasp that Oriental religions must be taken seriously by anyone interested in religion. Virtually all her Christian predecessors just wrote off Hinduism and Buddhism as superstition and idol worship, and confidently set about trying to bully the poor heathens into accepting the shining truths of their own particular Christian church or sect. Madame Blavatsky tried to learn from the monks and mahatmas of northern India, and thereby established the basis for today's respectful study of comparative religion, and for this she should be honoured. But alas, when she came down from the mountain and formed her Theosophical Society, she proved herself a charlatan. She dabbled with spiritualism and table-turning, something the great conjurer Harry Houdini was to expose as invariably self-delusion or conjuring tricks wherever he could test it. She claimed psychic or magical powers for both her mahatmas and herself. She prated about levitation and astral bodies and auras and teleportation and telepathy, and laid down a sound basis for Dennis Wheatley's sensational supernatural thrillers. She used her own conjuring tricks to deceive her own followers into believing in her special powers, and was exposed so doing. Her followers resolutely remained deceived. Her books, Isis Unveiled and the rest, seemed to mix the second hand with the invented and were really no use to serious students of religion and philosophy. But they suited the great charlatan, Aleister Crowley, as a model for his writings on the occult. Crowley was a brilliant if reckless mountaineer and a sub-Shelleyan poetaster who abandoned his strict Plymouth Brethren background. Hedonistic, Hellenistic anti-Christianity was in the air, the poet Swinburne being a good exemplar, and Crowley threw himself into investigating alternative occult traditions. He joined the Freemasons, hoping that their mysterious mumbo-jumbo contained mystical truths. He joined the Order of the Golden Dawn, a late Victorian parlour gathering of occultists, whose members at one time included the poet W.B. Yeats and Mrs. Oscar Wilde. The Golden Dawn spent much time trying out occult rigmaroles drawn from the Rosicrucian subdivision of Freemasonry, a lot of mysterious writing which purported to convey the wisdom of the hermetic seer Alexander Rosenkreutz. He never in fact existed. But his name means Red Cross, and this was the emblem of the Order of Knights Templar. It is just possible that Rosicrucian lore retains vestiges of secret signs and passwords, whereby surviving Templars recognized each other after the order had been forcibly suppressed in the 14th century. Philip the Fair of France, who began the persecution of the Templars, was motivated by greed for their enormous corporate properties. But he trumped up charges that they had been practicing witchcraft, and occultists who wanted to believe in magical lore were only too pleased to believe the trumped up charges and hope that the Templars' magical writings had been rediscovered. Crowley and a fellow crank called Gregor Mathers turned the Golden Dawn into an unashamed black magic society and vied with each other in cooking up rituals that were supposed to give them supernatural powers. Crowley's disgusting peak achievement was to baptize a frog, christen it Jesus Christ, and crucify it. This, he declared, made him Ipsissimus, the absolute self. The occult religion he proposed was one of self-indulgence, and he took as his motto, "Do what thou wilt shall be the whole of the law." As an anti-Christian who claimed that Christianity was now to be superseded by Crowleyanity, he enjoyed the Book of Revelations as much as the most fervent Branch Davidian. But Crowley was not the lamb. He identified with the baddies. In fact, he declared that he was the second beast described in chapter 13 of the Book of Revelations, a beast which had a number representing a man's name by the numerical value 666. This beast would enforce the worship of the first beast, which uttered blasphemies against God and was given authority over all the peoples of the earth. Before he ran through his own and his wife's money, Crowley was inspired by his guardian angel, he said, to go to the Great Pyramid and write down Liber Legis, the Book of the Law, occult gibberish which has been much used by later would-be adepts. He was inducted into a Masonic subsect, the Order of the Templars of the Orient, in Germany, and as head of this group, inducted others and offered to teach them mysterious lore. The First World War went rather badly for him. He signally failed to grow rich by passing himself off as a pro-German propagandist in America and had some awkward explaining to do when the USA joined the war. Crowley looked for a scarlet woman, too, the great whore of Revelations who rode upon the horn of the beast. When he found suitable women, he tended to give them rather a miserable life with too little food and too many drugs and some pretty disgusting sexual practices. Crowley was coming to decide that sex was magic, conferring power or bringing good luck. After being kicked out of Sicily, where he tried to set up an abbey of unrestrained self-indulgence and practiced magical bestiality with goats, Crowley wrote a book of Magic in Theory and Practice, magic being spelled with a K, and the whole privately published in Paris. And then he declined to peddling drugs and sex, and potions and scents, including his own semen as a main ingredient, all dressed up as magic for jaded decadence in London. The Second World War saw him living in genteelly straitened circumstances on the South Coast, where he died in 1947, and his tiny band of remaining followers celebrated the black mass he had devised and asked for at his graveside. He was a pretty dreary figure. But far from being the wickedest man in the world, as the gutter press luridly dubbed him. His day really came a couple of decades after his death. Gerald Gardner had met him and used some of his incantatory writing as part of the liturgy he devised for Wicca. The young American L. Ron Hubbard spent some time with Crowley, hopefully trying to learn occult powers. Presumably he learned that it was all fraudulent. Certainly he realized from Crowley's hopes for Crowleyanity that founding a new religion could be the biggest and best con of all. After a spell as a science fiction writer, Hubbard went on to found the Church of Scientology. And this combined the advantages of being a supposed church, which meant no tax to pay on its profits, with the spurious appeal of pseudoscience. Garbage about improving spiritual or mental health to become theta clear was ingeniously packaged with all the con man's art. One course led to another, which would really take the adept further to the next course, each demanding new fees and re-registration, naturally. Hubbard died a rich man, cruising the world on a large boat and so never having a base at which he became liable for income tax, waited on hand and foot by handsome, well-groomed acolytes. Concerned parents worried about their children being sucked into the embrace of this cult. But it has survived its founder, though it can hardly forever survive its lack of any real spiritual or philosophical basis. The other splendid con, based on Crowley's lurid imagination, is much more basic and blatant. Anton LaVey's Church of Satan, founded in 1966, is redolent of the cheap come-ons familiar to an old carnival barker. Which LaVey is. Silly costumes and ornaments, Disneyland settings for rituals, lots of naked girls, but none of Crowley's repulsive sex practices. These would suggest a very temporary life for the enterprise. LaVey himself, growing a little tubby for the horns, cape and tights he affects, looks more like the Demon King in the pantomime than a serious Satanist. But the philosophy of self-indulgent hedonism he proposes suited a period when some young people happily described themselves as the me generation, and others later welcomed a return to good old-fashioned greed. LaVey's Satanist's Bible has seemed required reading for most self-styled Satanists at some point in their careers. He praises self-interest and material ambition, encourages revenge, lambasts Christian belief in forgiveness and turning the other cheek. He describes Satan as the anti-altruistic spiritual force and suggests, like an obverse of the best modern Christian theologians, that he is to be found within each person rather than outside in hell with horns and a tail. LaVey encourages nurturing this personal spirit of self-seeking. The dedicated acolyte LaVey most proudly records was Jane Mansfield. I guess the bubble-headed blonde with the big boobs and the pink fur-lined bathroom was just the right intellectual weight to go along with it all. The rituals and rigmaroles and pretty pentagrams and naked women lying down with candles protruding from them as altars, not to mention the philosophy of calculated selfishness. One other satanic church crops up whenever black magic-associated murders in America are discussed. The process, or Church of the Final Judgment, has successfully started legal proceedings against two authors who linked them to Charles Manson and David Berkowitz, the son of Sam Keller. It was not hard for the process to show that there was no evidence that either Manson or Berkowitz had ever formally joined the church, and it is untrue to suggest that process teachings lead logically or inevitably to murder. But the weird theology of the process certainly does show some similarities to the Manson family's peculiar nasty beliefs. An ambitious English witch called Robert Moore founded the process. Unable to break Gerald Gardner's hold on English witchcraft, Moore changed his name to De Grimston and moved to California. In the counterculture atmosphere of the 60s, he found supporters for a church which venerated Adolf Hitler and revived the swastika as a mystical symbol. Some aspects of Scientology influenced the process. But at its heart, it is a dualistic church, worshipping Christ and Satan at the same time. The two, it claims, have buried the hatchet and rule together, Satan playing the role of avenger and punisher, and offering the power of evil and mystic experience of degradation to those who will follow his worship. When the age of Aquarius dawned in the 1960s, the hope was for a new age of peace and love, adorned with the beauty of flowers, the swirling charm of revived Art Nouveau decor, and the delight of healthy young naked bodies enjoying the experiences offered by mind-expanding chemicals and guilt-free lovemaking. Happiness was the goal, and happiness was manifestly not coming from industrial materialism or national military power or the sour face of official chastity. More cynically, the New Age could be written off as sex, drugs, and rock and roll. But underneath it, by no means at its centre, were little groups who combined superstition with ambition for crude material wealth and power. They seized on the New Age's rejection of old faiths to support their trends. They took the old left-hand path of declaring, "Evil, be thou my good." And they spawned cults that killed.